Yeah. You see, I
got tired.
The drinking is not my husband. I've been a non-drinker, but I also don't like the idea of going back to, you know, I'm trying to work out how you go back to drinking.
Hi, good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Strategy Planning Partnerships Committee, Tuesday, 6th of September. Strategy Planning and Partnerships Committee and the Infrastructure Public Space Committee public meeting will be streamed live and recorded for publishing to the internet. Please note that an audio and visual recording is taken of this meeting. This means that your presence at and any or all contribution you make to the meeting may be collected, used, disclosed or published publicly by the council, including transferring outside of Australia. And I've been told that we have a nice new green light here that tells you when we are live streaming, and when it's red, we're not. So there you go. The Strategy Planning and Partnerships Committee acknowledges that we're meeting on the traditional country of the Kaurna people of Adelaide Plains and pays respect to elders past and present. We recognise and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs and relationship with the land. We acknowledge their continued importance to the Kaurna people living today. Agenda item number 2, I have an apology from Councillor Martin. I'm not sure about Councillor Flerahan or Wilkinson. Anyone heard from either of those people? Right, we'll just note them as apologies for now. May I have confirmation of minutes for the Lord Mayor, 2nd of August, Councillor Slammer? Anyone like to speak to that? I'll put that. All those in favour? Declare that carried. Members have no public forum, no verbal report. I'll now call for items for adoption on block. Item number 7. Pulling that out, Councillor Corbell. Item number 8. Councillor Deshaw. Item number 9. Item number 10. Item number 11. No out of session papers. That's it. Oh, sorry. My apologies. Item number 12. Sorry. Members, I'll call for a mover for items 9, 10, 11, and 12. Deputy Lord Mayor and Lord Mayor seconding. I'll put that. All those in favour? Declare that carried. Members, I'll now move to item number 7, Councillor Corbell.
Thank you, Chair. Look, I won't say too much. I just really wanted to call this out because the reason for the report that we've received is largely as a result of the hard work of the administration and the fact that we want to enhance as a city the free bike scheme which we've had in place since 2005. And this report details to great length what the next steps are, in particular opportunities for docking stations and for point-to-point pick-up and drop-off of a bike share scheme, which will be key enhancements, and the co-contribution of state government, $500,000, with Adelaide City Council, $500,000, to bring this up to a $1 million project. So I just wanted to say good work to the team that's put this report together.
Councillor Corbell, before you continue, we actually have Dr. Elliot Fishman, who's director of the Institute for Sensible Transport, who is here to do a very brief presentation on this matter. So I'll welcome, and I'll just hand over to you to commence your presentation.
Thank you very much. So thank you very much for the opportunity to present to you tonight, which is really on the work that I've done over the last, since the latter part of last year on bike share options for Adelaide. So really, it was composed of three reports. The first one was an international review of bike share successes and barriers and ways of doing it well in Australia. And then the second report was on a stakeholder consultation session that was run here at the City of Adelaide with partnering councils or neighbouring councils, I should say, looking at what they thought were some of the opportunities and constraints for a future bike share scheme in Adelaide. And then the final and perhaps most substantive report was the options for Adelaide, so design an options assessment for Adelaide. So that was the one that looked at a fairly detailed assessment at what a bike share scheme might look like for Adelaide. And I'll present some of the work from that report this evening. So just in case some of you aren't familiar with what a bike share scheme is, I've just got a picture here of one that operates in the US. And this is how almost all of them operate. There are over 1,000 now, 1,000 cities that operate a bike share scheme. And the way they work is they have an automated internet connected docking station. And once you've signed up, you can put a small radio frequency ID tag or ID card against one of the bikes, it unlocks the bike for you, and then you can ride it either back to that docking station or much more commonly to another docking station, any one of potentially hundreds or even in the case of Paris, thousands of different docking stations across the city. And then you end your trip and then the bike is there for someone else to use. So if bike share is the answer, as a lot of cities are coming to that realisation, I'd put it to you, what's the question? And what is it that you'd want bike share to achieve for your city? What are the outcomes that you hope that bike share might be able to help your city achieve? And I've got a picture here from the Melbourne Bike Share Scheme, which is a scheme that hasn't been running all that well. It has a very low level of use, and the execution and implementation of the bike share scheme could have been done much better. And so it's very important not just to be focused on the end point of, yes, we want a bike share scheme, but to think about what are the details of that bike share scheme and how it worked best in a city like Adelaide to ensure that the bikes aren't just there on the docking stations on every street corner, but are actually being used and being driven around the city as the scheme components intended for them. In terms of bike share's growth, there's been a huge growth, especially since about 2005 and 2007, when Lyon and Paris launched their bike share schemes, and that created a lot of international interest. And since then, bike share has really been booming. And this is an old graph, this is from 2013, and there's now over 1,000 cities that have a bike share program. This graph, and I'm sorry to give you a graph this busy so late in the day, this tracks the level of use for different bike share schemes across the world. So each bike share scheme obviously has their own number of bikes in there, but if you look at the number of trips per day per bike, you get some sort of measure of just how busy the scheme is. And you can see that there's a great deal of variation in there. So a city like Barcelona has 6, 7, sometimes 8 trips per day per bike. And you can see Brisbane and Melbourne down the bottom there with Brisbane between 0.3 and 0.5 trips per day per bike. Melbourne, its highest month was 1.1 trips per day per bike. So what we're hoping, the reason I'm showing this to you is because I would hope that any additional city in Australia that wants to introduce a bike share scheme would do things to ensure that they're not hovering down the bottom where Brisbane is. I don't think that's an outcome that anyone in Brisbane City Council had hoped for when they launched their bike share scheme, and I'm sure it's not the outcome that anyone in Adelaide would like to see either. So bike share benefits for Adelaide, I think it's worth discussing these. Often they're self-explanatory, but it might just be worth briefly identifying them now. Enhanced transport choice is one of the key benefits from bike share. Increased physical activity, because of course any trip, especially ones that forego a car trip and are replaced by bike share, has a health benefit. And for the same reason, they can reduce congestion and lower transport costs as well. There's also strong strategic alignment. And I know that some of these strategic goals might have changed slightly in recent times, but certainly carbon neutral Adelaide is one where there's strong strategic alignment. And also, and this is one, of course, that's changed a little bit, but still, I think the new goal is also very much consistent with bike share, which is welcoming and dynamic city full of rich experience, rich and diverse experiences. And certainly anyone that has had the opportunity to visit a city that has bike share, if you've ridden on there, I'm sure you'll agree that it creates an individualized, independent way of experiencing a city. And that's something that I think people could enjoy in Adelaide as well. And also a festival city, and because Adelaide hosts so many festivals throughout the year, bike share is a great way for people to experience Adelaide in a slower, independent way. This slide is something that I think is worth spending some time on. It looks at Adelaide and what's the situation, what's the context in Adelaide that could work against a successful bike share scheme, and what are some of the factors that could be introduced in order to increase the chances of Adelaide supporting a well-used bike share scheme. So the negative factors, if you like, are the ones in black, the icons on the left-hand side of the graph. So low traffic congestion, low density, reasonably plentiful, low-cost car parking, perhaps a cultural resistance to mode choice changes. These are the things that work against a well-used bike share scheme, and some of these are present in Adelaide. And then the icons on the right-hand side are the things that could be implemented as part of a bike share system that would work to increase usage. So bicycle-friendly design, so more bike lanes and bike paths, which I understand there's been some progress on from a funding perspective over recent months. Network benefits, so having a large enough scheme that you can actually get from where you live to where you work and to visit friends and family. Having the first year free makes sense to me, especially given the legacy of having the Adelaide Free Bike Scheme. Having a smartphone accessible, so it's really easy to join. So the gap between when someone thinks that maybe they might like to use bike share to when they can actually get on the bike is as short an amount of time as possible, given that the average trip for a bike share journey is only 15 or 16 minutes. So you don't want to spend a lot of time signing up. Having an electric assist might work as well, and there are a lot of cities that are now introducing bike share schemes that have electric assist bicycles. And having a smart car integration is something that a lot of cities are noticing improves levels of use. And then the final one, which is probably the most controversial, is the idea of voluntary helmets. And I'm certainly not advocating that you should go down a voluntary helmet route, but I think there's scope there for some research. Sure.
Scrub that one right.
Okay. So, okay, well, why don't we just move on and
Wisely.
So, one of the questions that I think is worth pondering for a city that is interested in bike share, a modern bike share scheme, is what is the compelling value proposition for enough people to choose bike share? So, thinking about it from a rider's perspective, that is something that I think is really important, because if you think about it and you can't think about a situation which you or anyone that you know might use it, then that's probably something that will have ramifications for the ultimate level of use for bike share.
Sorry, I just realised you haven't got the microphone on in front of you. Would you mind just popping the speak button? Thank you.
Okay, sorry about that. So thinking about that value proposition is really important. One of the things that we did for Adelaide, and Adelaide's actually the first city in the world that has had this done, is a bike share propensity index, where we've divided Adelaide into over, I think, 2,300 small parcels of land from a geographic perspective, and looked at the characteristics of those individual parcels of land and developed a bike share propensity index. So most of the data is drawn from the ABS, so we've looked at residential population density, employment density, the density of young adults, so these are households with adults that are aged between 18 and 34, because they're statistically more likely to be bike share users than adults of other ages. The proportion of people in suburbs of Adelaide that have city-based employment, because if you work in the city, you're more likely to be a bike share member, because you're going to experience some of the results of congestion and parking constraints or costs that will then encourage you to think differently about what mode of transport you might use. Low car ownership, so households, the proportion of households with one or zero cars. The level of bike use in terms of residential location, and also the level of bike use in terms of journey to work for the destination, so where people are actually going. So this is what it looks like on a map of Adelaide. So the darker the area, the more likely that area is to hold people that have a propensity for bike share use relative to the lighter areas. And I've also got this a conceptual design for where docking stations might go as well, to try and maximize the likelihood that those docking stations will contain bikes that are well used, because bike share can be expensive and you want to put the docking stations where they have the highest propensity for use. And the catchment area and the density has been designed so that you're, if you're in the catchment, you're never more than 4 minutes or so walk from the next closest docking station. And so that was phase one there. And then in the report, we also had a second phase. So this is both phases joined together to show what ultimately, and this might be some years down the track from now, a bike share scheme might look like in Adelaide. So if you think about that earlier slide that I showed you with the bike station, the docking station with the bikes in it, thinking about lots of them all around Adelaide as the map indicates, with each circle indicating a catchment for each docking station. But it's also important to recognise that although those maps are exciting and we enjoy doing them and we enjoy looking at the various technology and hardware that is now available within the bike share sector, it's also important to have a reality-based position on this based on the context that Adelaide finds itself in. And that is that Adelaide does not currently have the necessary preconditions to support a successful bike share scheme because of the reasons that I've mentioned earlier. So the low density, the ease of car use, the cultural resistance to other modes of transport, the lack of bicycle infrastructure relative to other cities that have bike share schemes. So for those reasons, it's important to understand that there are a lot of things that need to be done before you could expect to be able to launch a bike share scheme that is reasonably well used. So I've got a section on staged implementation. So if you start at the top, where we are now, 2016, these are all the things that I think would need to be done in order to have a realistic prospect, a reasonable prospect of having a successful bike share scheme. So I won't go through them in any great detail, but it involves a little bit more analysis. It involves some market research to understand the barriers to bike share in Adelaide and also the market preferences. So who would use a bike share scheme in Adelaide, a modern bike share scheme, and under what conditions would they use it? Developing the bicycle infrastructure is essential, and I don't think any city has launched a bike share scheme with an underdeveloped bicycle network and still had a well-used scheme. And then there's a whole range of other activities that need to occur, like the development of a request for proposal. So you can put out a proposal to the market, which is a very competitive, active commercial sector at the moment, in order to receive submissions from people, from organisations that could supply the bikes and manage the bike share scheme. So there's a range of activities that need to take place, and a lot of them can't be done in a short amount of time, particularly the development of the bicycle infrastructure network. And I would always be hesitant to be able to launch a scheme without having the necessary bicycle infrastructure, because when you ask people in cities like Melbourne and Brisbane why you haven't used bike share before, the most common reason is I don't feel safe riding a bike in the city. And that might happen in Adelaide as well. We also looked at a range of different bike share schemes and their level of use. This is similar to the graph that I showed earlier. And then we provided a high level estimate of what Adelaide might expect if it did all those things that I've talked about, those icons that were in white a few slides back. If all those things were done, this is what you might be able to expect for a really well executed bike share scheme once the infrastructure has been laid down to support safe cycling. So around 1.5 to 2 trips per day per bike, I think, is realistic if all those things were done. And it's important to recognise that if you do all those things, you're still not going to get a Paris-style bike share scheme in terms of the level of use. There are some fundamental constraints in terms of density that can't be changed in 5 or 6 years. They're long-term things, and until those change, no one could ever expect that Adelaide would be able to achieve the levels of ridership of Paris or Barcelona, for instance. So in summary, people don't make transport decisions in isolation. They'll always weigh up, if bike share was present on the streets of Adelaide, people will still always weigh up the relative convenience for them to use their existing modes of transport or to use bike share. And if there isn't a compelling case for them to switch from their previous mode of transport onto bike share, then people will probably stick to their current mode of transport. So it's really important to take a view of this that puts you in the rider's seat, essentially, and is there a compelling case for them to use bike share? It's clear, as I've mentioned before, that Adelaide does not currently have necessary conditions to support a well-used bike share scheme. And safer infrastructure, better data, and helmet research must be undertaken in order to get over some of those hurdles that would present as barriers to bike share for a lot of people. But bike share is a positive step Adelaide can take to begin the transition to a more sustainable carbon neutral transport system. So although it's really the beginning of the road, I think it's a road worth travelling down, because ultimately it will help provide people with the transport options so that they can lower their car use and also provide an important tourist activity for people that are visiting Adelaide. So look, they're all the key slides that I had for this evening. I've got some other ones that might need to come up if I get some questions if those slides are relevant. So I'm happy to try and answer your questions.
Members, I'll open it up for questions. Just, can I just get some clarity? The existing free bike that we have and the bike share you refer to, what? Can you just get clarity?
Sorry, the clarity.
Free bike game.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's probably something that Tanya might.
I'm just trying to, for everyone to understand the difference, I just wanted to start from that place. The free bike scheme we currently have versus bike share scheme that we're now contemplating.
Yeah. So through the chair, the existing Adelaide free bike scheme, as you all know, is run by Bike SA. It comprises of about 200 bikes. We basically have volunteer businesses that choose to host the bikes. Those bikes are only available whilst that business is open, and the bikes aren't stored outside. Well, they're stored outside, but when the bikes, when the business is closed, the bikes go back inside to keep them in their good condition. And they're not available 24/7, and they don't have the A to B. So that's the key aspect of a more sophisticated public bike share scheme, is that it provides that convenience of A to B, and that it's available 24/7.
Okay. Now I've got Councillor Antic, who has a question, and the Lord Mayor. Maybe Dr. Fishman, you want to swap back into that chair? Councillor
Antic. Yeah, I think, well, actually my first question was answered by Dr. Fishman, actually, about the issue of how this would relate to a city which doesn't have a proper bike infrastructure network. And this might actually be more appropriate for the debate on the...
Just for questions now.
Yeah, well, I guess the question was, I still couldn't quite work out from the material whether or not how it is we got to $1 million out of the... I mean, just briefly, without going to every nut and bolt. Clearly it depends on the number of stations, the number of bikes, and the number of this, that, the other,
this motion is going to talk about some preparatory work,
yeah,
and due diligence, mm, relating to this project that could, the project itself could be up to $1 million. So I think the we'll come back to that with the debate.
Preparatory work, my other question for now.
Lord Mayor.
Thanks, Chair. Dr. Fishman, can I just gain some clarity from you about this relationship, I guess, between demand, supply and usage? So when you shared that, for example, Melbourne and Brisbane are not experiencing the usages which they may have reasonably expected versus certainly other cities internationally, we've got some papers here which suggest that, you know, 40 infrastructure points throughout the City of Adelaide might be an appropriate starting point. That would be 400 bikes, 10 per rack, etc., etc., etc. But what is that relationship? Let's say, for example, Doctor, if there was half of that amount, does that then kick the usage rate up?
It doesn't, because you lose the network benefits. If a scheme is constrained in terms of its geographical coverage, it limits the degree to which people can make trips from one place to another place that they need to go. And so even though on the metric of trips per day per bike would, one might think, increase if you've got less bikes, because if you have the same amount of use but less bikes, then that metric looks better. I understand that point. But the evidence from the cities that I've looked at, and certainly Melbourne is a good case in point, where the docking stations are almost entirely in the CBD or central city area, and it limits the degree to which bike share offers an attractive transport option for people, because they could really walk to wherever they needed to go anyway, because the catchment is so small. So I would always caution a city, depending upon the geography and the size of the city itself, I'd caution against moving to a small scheme, especially if the interest is in seeing it as a risky proposition, so we'll make it smaller in order to minimise our risk or our exposure to risk, because you can in some ways increase your exposure to risk because the value proposition to a potential user becomes smaller as the scheme becomes more constrained from a geographical perspective.
Thanks, Dr. Chair. I've just got one more if I could, please. Do, in your experience, Doctor, do cities grow into this infrastructure? Like, is there an intrinsic value in setting them up and sending a clear signal, I guess, to all and sundry that cycling is important? And then cities over time grow into this type of infrastructure and their usage then responds accordingly. Have you seen any examples of that globally?
Yeah, there are a number of examples of that actually. So the cities that I would point to that are good demonstrations of that would be New York City, which had a very low level of bike use prior to the implementation of their bike scheme in 2013. It wasn't known as a bike city, but it has fostered a much greater level of participation. And in actual fact, Paris is the same example. And not only did now 1 in 5 trips in Paris that are on bike, are on a bike share bike, but not just the increase in cycling that occurred because of the bike share scheme, but actually sales of private bikes at bike shops went up. So it does foster this a culture of cycling that might not have been there previously. And it also serves to normalize cycling because very few of those cyclists that use bike share schemes are lycra-based cyclists. So they wear normal work clothes or casual clothes. And that serves to normalize the image of cycling in a city that hasn't previously had a strong culture of cycling.
Chair, in closing, I must say 5 weeks ago, I used this system in New York City. New York must be the most least cycling friendly city on the planet, but I did it, and many, many people do. I mean, Adelaide is nirvana compared to New York when it comes to cycling. And I survived, and it was a great experience. So thanks, Dr.
Thanks, Lord Mayor. I'd just like to welcome Council Wilkinson and Councillor Clarahan. We're just in the presentation for agenda item number 7. Councillor Clarahan, the next with a question.
Thank you. I just wondered whether you had a look at whether topography plays any factor in the uptake of cycling.
The answer to that question is yes, and that's true not just for private cycling, but also for bike share bikes, bike share cycling. And in fact, the issue of topography is even more pronounced for cycling with shared bicycles because they're heavier and they typically have less gears. They're heavier because they have security functions that minimise vandalism, but that makes riding up hills harder. And in Brisbane, which had to address this issue because of course Brisbane's a hilly city, they chose not to put docking stations in the areas of Brisbane that had hills. And there are other ways that cities have gone about doing this as well. So one of the ways that's available now that wasn't available when Brisbane launched its scheme in 2010 was electric assist bicycles. And that's something that in a recently completed report that I led for Sydney, we recommended electric assist bicycles because of the topography associated with Sydney.
And one more question, and that was around the uptake in relation to motor vehicle speeds, whether you've survey those places that where the cycling or the bike shares have been taken up. What was there any correlation?
I haven't looked at that from a quantitative perspective, but I have been involved in a number of focus groups where when people are pressed on what it is about cycling on city streets that concerns them, motor vehicle speed and volume are the key things that they bring up. So it's a qualitative answer to that.
And again, there's complexity as to the degree, I suppose, or the quality of cycling infrastructure.
Yes.
It's not straightforward, I imagine.
No, that's right. And the clear indication from the research that I've looked at is protected bicycle lanes offer a much more attractive environment for would-be cyclists. So people that don't cycle a lot now but are thinking about it, they're open to that question, and they need some sort of vertical separation between them and a moving car. A line of paint isn't something that they're satisfied with.
Okay, I've got Councillor Abiad, Councillor Cobell, Deputy Lord Mayor and Councillor Wilkinson. Councillor Abiad, you know, okay. Councillor Cobell.
Thank you. Yeah, my question was has sort of pretty much been answered. Like you did mention in your presentation, there's lots of different influencing factors that will determine the success of this bike share scheme here in our city, like people wearing helmets or not, and also the infrastructure. We're coupling this bike share scheme with enhancements to our existing infrastructure. How strong is that relationship? If we spend the remaining 11 million of this budget on enhancements to cycling infrastructure, how strong a relationship is that to ensure the success of this?
Well, it's a very strong relationship. So the evidence from overseas is that the successful cities, the cities that have implemented bike share successfully, have all undergone a bicycle infrastructure building program in the years prior to the launch of their bike share scheme. So Paris did that, New York certainly did that, Philadelphia did that, a range of cities have done that, and they've had high levels of bike share use as a consequence. The cities that haven't done it haven't done so well in terms of their level of use. So I think it's essential.
Deputy Lord Mayor.
I've got a few questions, but are you therefore saying that bike infrastructure really comes first?
My view is that bike share ought to come first because this is an old way of looking at it, but transport systems are composed of three parts. There's the terminal capacity, there's the rights of way, and there's the vehicle. So if you think about it in terms of shipping, there's shipping lanes, they're the rights of way, terminal capacity are the ports, and the vehicles are the ships. So with bike share, it includes the terminal capacity, the docking stations, it includes the vehicle, the bikes, but the rights of way are an essential ingredient in that three-part mix. And unless you have the bike lanes to allow the rights of way for those bikes to move around safely, and more importantly, those cyclists to move around safely, then it will always be difficult to encourage people onto bikes. Now, the other way of looking at it is, and this is how some cities have done it, is that they put in the bike share scheme, knowing that there'll be public pressure to then lay down greater levels of protected bike lanes because they've got a bike share scheme that isn't doing well and it needs to be enhanced and supported through bicycle infrastructure. So it can work the other way as well, but my preference as a bike share plan would be to put in the infrastructure first and then the bike share scheme.
We've had some reports on this before. Just if I can preface it by saying I'm a cyclist and I use bike shares in other cities, so I'm a supporter of it, but I do have some concerns about it being rolled out in Adelaide and how we're going to roll them out in Adelaide. So we've got a small CBD, which means you can actually walk from one side of the city to the other, to the extremity to extremity in 20 or 25 to 30 minutes, I suppose. We've also got high levels of bike ownership, and we've been told in previous reports that what that means is that those people who do want to commute, and you know, I notice a number in the dream model, a number of the nodes are out in the suburbs, which you would expect that commute from. But those people who do want to commute, unlike many other countries, we've all got bikes in our back sheds, and we've got houses big enough to house them, you know, unlike New York and places like that. So we've got a small CBD, we've got low density housing, and we've got high levels of bike ownership. So people aren't being precluded from using a bike because they can't access one at the moment. There are other things stopping it. Is there an example of another city that you know of that has that sort of mix that where it's worked successfully? I mean, I'm worried about us. Worried about it being a white elephant.
Yeah, I agree with all of those points. I think they were quite insightful, and I share the same concerns. The city that I think could be drawn upon that has a similar characteristic, not exactly the same, but similar, would be Minneapolis, St. Paul in the US that has essentially the characteristics that you've just described, perhaps not to the same extent as Adelaide, but similar. And they have between, I think it's 1.2 and 1.8 trips per day per bike, okay. But it's a very well executed system. So they've done it as much as they can, given the built form constraints that that city has to get as much out of their bike share system as possible.
Okay, thank you. I'll have to have a trip, obviously.
Yep.
one more question, if you don't mind, Chair. Have you looked at our current scheme, which has some significant strengths, I think? I mean, it's free. It's very basic and simple and relatively cheap. But it also does enable tourists who, I know it's at the moment mainly being used by tourists, so as I understand about 90% of the people who use it are tourists. But it does have that capacity for people to take a bike for a day and therefore really explore the city and ride down to Henry Beach and back and do grander things like that, which would probably be discouraged with a bike share scheme where the ones that I've used, at least, you get the first hour free and after that it clocks up, and it actually starts to clock up at a decent old rate. So have you had a look at our scheme and given any consideration to whether, rather than starting up adopting a scheme that's, you know, we find in another city, using our own scheme as a basis for something that's sort of completely Adelaide's own?
Well, I'm familiar with the Adelaide Free Bikes scheme. Actually, on my way here, I saw some people doing exactly what you've just described, some people coming back from Henley Beach after having a trip and they were clearly tourists. My response to that would be to survey the people that currently use the Adelaide Free Bike Scheme to understand why they use it, and then test them as to whether they would be interested in using a more modern bike share scheme. And for a lot of people, especially international tourists, they may well come from a city or have visited a city that has a modern bike share scheme, so they may know about it already. And to see to what degree that 30-minute, usually it's a 30-minute limit, it could be a 45-minute limit before you start to get excessive usage charges, to see to what extent they would accept that and what level of charge would be acceptable to them. It may well be, and this certainly happens in other cities that have bike share schemes that are big tourist cities, so Washington or New York or London, the way that they're used is that the tourists are more likely to run into overage charges, as they call them in the US, where you might use the bike for 2 hours. But very often, they'll just dock the bike when it comes to the end of their hire period, and then go into a museum or a cafe, and then come back out and pick out another bike and continue riding. But it would be really useful and not all that difficult to survey the users of the Adelaide Bike Share, the Adelaide Free Bikes scheme, because I can appreciate that that is a scheme that a lot of people are passionate about, and tourists certainly love it, and you wouldn't want to erode that base with the introduction of a more technologically advanced scheme. So understanding what their preferences are is really important.
And are there any cities that have middle ground? I mean, ours is a very, very low tech, and the ones we're looking at here are very high tech. Are there any middle ground programs?
None that I'm aware of. All cities that I'm aware of choose one and roll that out across their city rather than running two schemes in parallel. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Councillor Wilkerson.
Thank you. With the point-to-point scheme, which is this new initiative.
There's a question. We're not into the debate yet.
It is a question. That's why it all started. With the point-to-point thing, what's the situation about like tidal flow? You get trends of people wanting to go from this side of the city to that side of the city, if they all end up in the same spot, and then there's not enough spots to put them where they all want to end up in different times of day. And how do we manage that? We have vans driving around ferrying the bikes back to the...
Well, you've raised a very good question, and that is something that a lot of bike share schemes struggle with, especially well-used bike share schemes that have a very defined residential area of their city and a very defined commercial precinct, because of course all the bikes get picked up from the residential areas at about between 8:20 and 8:40 in the morning on a weekday, and they get dumped into the central part of the city, and they overwhelm the docking stations that are available to take them. And so cities need to run in very popular areas that have high levels of employment density. They need to have trucks moving bikes back out into areas that have docking stations that are that have lower levels of capacity. So lower bike parking. So that is a problem, and it's costly as well. It ends up meaning that each bike in a bike share scheme has an operating cost of about $2,000 a year, and a substantial proportion of that cost goes to rebalancing. And it's not a job that any bike share operator likes, because it's very costly, and often they're using trucks in the central area of the city at peak driving time, because that's when the problems arise. So there are things that you can do to try and minimize that, like pricing incentives. If people are moving bikes from areas known to have capacity issues to areas that have low concentrations of bikes, then they get a credit on their account, which means that they can ride for a longer period of time before they get charged, those sorts of things. That's what New York's trialling at the moment for the very reason that you mentioned.
Councillor Michelle.
Mine's more of a comment as a follow-up of Megan's. In Japan, you just ride your bike to the station, and when you come back to the station, you take whatever bike's left.
Hmm.
So your bike might not necessarily be there when you get back, but there's a bike there when you get back. So it's actually a community bike share scheme. The bikes are generally not in great nick. But everybody has a bike, and they just park them, and you come out, and you take a bike, and you go home.
Someone's bike.
So, which is really terrible the first time you do it.
Stealing bikes. All right, now, thank you, Dr. Fishman, for your presentation. Councillor Corbell, are you moving as printed, or are you moving in the item?
I am moving as printed.
Do I have a seconder? Lord Mayor.
Thank you. Oh, look, we've had quite a lengthy discussion, and really I'm very keen to support this $1 million of the $12 million co-contribution between Adelaide City Council and the state government to enhance the cycling infrastructure in the city and to put it towards a free bike share scheme. And I think it's important that we do our groundwork. There's obviously a lot of influencing factors that we have to take into consideration, and we do need a tailored model specific to Adelaide. And we need to preempt the needs of the users, so the residents and encouraging them to use it, and the existing users of our free bike share scheme, which are generally the tourists.
Thanks, Chair. Chair, can I just look to administration for a little bit of clarity before I speak to the matter? The point one of the recommendation, can I just triple check? I think I see the intent, but the wording could be construed as ambiguous, Chair.
I'm just asking the same question, I believe.
No, are we here? You are. Yes, Chair. Are we actually, is this recommendation to spend $1 million on due diligence?
I was just asking to my right the same question. Right. I could get some very clear clarity on that answer from Beth. Is it?
Yep.
Thank you. Thank you, Chair. No, the $1 million, to be really, really clear, is not for due diligence. The $1 million would be, or the initial phase would be further investigation and some due diligence. Depending on the outcomes of the preparatory work and due diligence, that would be for the stage of the proposed scheme for the City of Adelaide for up to $1 million, which is outlined.
That's for the scheme
really
itself.
30. Yes. Paragraph 34, that's correct.
I actually don't like the wording, I have to admit. I'll get Councillor Antic is next to speak to this, and I'll just have a quick think, and we might vary it slightly.
Thanks, Chair. I'm sure Councillor Corbell might be able to do the variation too. Just make sure that wording is very, very tight, because it is a little ambiguous in terms of how it's written. I think we'd all have a heart attack if we thought there was going to be $1 million spent on due diligence. But thank you, Beth. We're all breathing again. Chair, if I can speak to the matter, I think, members, you'd recall from Councillor Moran's motion, followed by Councillor Corbell's amendment to include this bike share program, that part of it was to instruct myself to contact adjoining mayors from adjoining councils to just get an early read on the appetite from our neighbouring councils as to whether they would work with us in some form of shared infrastructure for the short, medium and long term. And I must say that that's come back with a resounding yes. Now, I certainly understand that's the view of the mayors, and that would have to go through a process in their councils. But you probably think there's some indicative read there, that it's something that's certainly entertaining working with council on. So I think it does get back a little bit to City of Adelaide's leadership role here. I think we kind of get, this is a unique position, that we've got a very solid commitment from this council and from the state government of South Australia in a mutual equal partnership of 50-50 each for this bikeways project, of which the point-to-point system is a part of. So I don't want this to see as an opportunity lost. And that's why I was asking the doctor the questions about, do cities grow into this infrastructure? And New York was an interesting analogy, Chair. whereby, I mean, on the surface of it, why would you ride your cycle or your bicycle in New York? But everybody does. And it's an interesting analogy. It's obviously working there. So a couple of things to share, that something must be going right here, Chair, because if this started with three cities only 10 years ago, and now there's 1,000 cities around the world, you have to say that something's happening here, and something's happening which is good. So there are cities that are enjoying this, and it's working. And we've obviously got 1,000 case studies from which we can learn from to come up with a system which is well suited to Adelaide. We've got rising residential density, Chair, in our city. The tourism numbers came out now 2.5 to 3 weeks ago, and they're looking pretty rosy. So we've got obviously a great growth in tourism. We know there's a strong connection between tourists and these systems. I'd be a little alarmed if it was to take us 4 years to realise this opportunity, I must say, Chair. I was a little bit shocked to hear that. But I think this is just a great, I support the recommendation. I think this is a great opportunity, and I don't want to see it as a lost opportunity. Thanks, Chair.
Thank you. Okay, I'm just going to just to get some clarity. It's a very simple solution to the potential problem. It's put a full stop at the end of City of Adelaide. Mm-hmm. And delete the rest.
Yeah.
And if I could just get the mover's permission to that variation and the seconders, and I'll just put that to the all those in the chamber, all those in favour. Go that carry, is that correct? Yeah. Brown, are you got a vote against?
We just have to think about it.
No, not the motion, just the amendment.
I'm we're just varying it slightly to give the clarity that the pre-work is not at the cost of $1 million. It is to undertake the pre-work relating to a scheme that has potentially a budget of.
You clear? I don't understand that. What are we about spending? It says 50,000.
You can when it comes to your turn,
and it says the rest of the 950,000 next year. We are allocating.
We don't want to. That's the time.
No, I think. It's just to do the proper. Beth, can I get you to get some clarity?
Thank you, Chair. Just to be really clear, the council resolution in July committed up to $1 million for a bike share within the City of Adelaide. The proposal tonight is to commence that preparatory work and due diligence, which would then come back to council. The actual proposal is, if we refer to paragraph 34, it's probably the clearest piece, 33, 34, is talking about a proposed scheme which would cost up to $1 million within the City of Adelaide. The further scheme, should it proceed in adjoining councils, would scale from there.
So, Beth, I'm just correct with Ron. The pre-work will tell us exactly what the cost of the scheme will be.
Correct. And we'll bring that back to council.
Everyone clear on that? Okay, Councillor Antic.
Thank you, Chair. Look, I speak in opposition to this. This council has become obsessed with the bicycle. I don't have a problem with the concept. I think that this is potentially a very meritorious approach, but can I just remind members of, just following on from what Beth just said, what is being proposed here, notwithstanding the removal of those words, we've heard from Dr. Fleischmann this afternoon that that we really are putting the cart before the horse by putting this scheme into play immediately. I think I'm paraphrasing there, but my understanding of the $6 million co-fund between the state government and the Adelaide City Council was that money was to be put into proper infrastructure. That is, we have to get a house in order before we start dealing with the icing on the cake. And this, to me, is total icing on the cake. My understanding of this is that the $1 million pilot proposal, sure, there's a $50,000 initial outlay in terms of having that due diligence process. But if the $1 million pilot proposal gets up, if you look at the map that's attached to the agenda, it's a pilot project for 200 bikes, 40 docking stations, catchment area of the City of Adelaide, North Adelaide, and a capital expenditure of approximately $1.2 million. The annual operating costs are TBA. And the ridership is TBA. There are too many unknowns to this. I don't understand. And then if we go a step further and we get the other councils involved, I mean, this is a pretty important observation. The capital expenditure is said to be between $9.7 to $21 million. Now, we don't know who's paying for that, but we're being led by the nose into this. This may not be a great idea. We may not get the bike network we want. This might turn out to be a total flop and disaster. I just think we're being absolutely reckless in walking into this. I think we need to cool our jets a little bit, and so I won't support this. The idea may well be very meritorious, but it's far too soon. And I would encourage members to just be very careful about the path we cycle down into this motion.
Debbie Lawbear.
Look, I share a number of Councillor Antic's concerns, but I think they've actually been addressed by the removal of the words at the end, because all we're doing now is asking our administration to undertake some preparatory work and due diligence work. I think that's actually a feasibility study. In order we see whether we are going to spend $1 million on this. We have got up to, we've already passed a motion that says we've got up to $1 million to spend on it. So that motion was passed in July, and I think Councillor Antic voted for that motion. So we've got $1 million, up to $1 million set aside. Had the variation not been made, I would have actually moved that as an amendment, because I'm very clear that I'm, like Councillor Antic, not 100% sure that this does have legs, and I'm also dead sure that we wouldn't want to be committing at this stage to starting any scheme in 2018 necessarily. So I'm interested in us doing the feasibility work. I think that's a really important thing to do to see whether this has got legs. I'm interested in us having a modern bike program. Our current one, while it works for some people, doesn't really work for commuters, and it is a little bit daggy. But it's lovable, but daggy. So it would be nice to have something in a city where we're trying to be a modern city, to have something that was more impressive. But I don't necessarily think that the New York model is going to work for us, and I want us to investigate what models will work for us, given the constraints of our city. We want to have a close look at the Minneapolis, St. Paul, whichever operation, see how that worked. So as far as I'm concerned, I'm happy to support this on the basis that preparatory work and due diligence work is effectively a feasibility, includes a feasibility study, that we're not seeing this as a fait accompli. We're actually really looking hard at it and testing whether it's going to work for our city, because the last thing we want to do is destroy an effective and well-loved free bike scheme to replace it with a not very well-loved, poorly taken up pay scheme or more modern scheme.
Thank you. Before we go to Councillor Moran, can we just have someone move an adjournment of this meeting so we can open the next meeting on time? Councillor Corbell, seconded by Councillor Antic. Put that, all those in favour. Declare that carried. I adjourn this meeting.
Thank you, Councillor Mullaney. As Chair of the Construction and Public Space Committee, I declare the Construction and Public Space Committee open and call for an adjournment. If I move it, Councillor Carrahan, seconded Deputy Lord Mayor. All those in favour of an adjournment? Those opposed? That's carried. I now adjourn the meeting. Pass back to you, Councillor Mullaney.
I'll reopen the Strategy Planning and Partnerships Committee meeting. Just wanted to clarify, Deputy Lord Mayor, you mentioned feasibility study. Will the administration take it on notice that is the context of which this is being read out when it says preparatory work and due diligence? Unless you want those words added. It's up to you. Take it on notice? Okay, thank you. Councillor Moran?
I'll foreshadow if this motion fails that this be shifted forward to budgets. I'm speaking to this. The reason I move that is I think it's good and we should look at that, but it's way too early. We haven't even started designing our bike lanes, separate bike lanes, and the experts clearly said that has to be in place. I've got a motion later on which I know will fail, which I'm still gobsmacked why it will fail, that we redo Frome Road as per Yarndell's designs. I've sent everybody millions of pictures from Denmark and Amsterdam and everywhere with the measurements clearly in them. I received no reply. but I still kept setting them. My point is that we don't need to reinvent the wheel. The rest of the world, the European countries, have exactly the same bike lanes with slightly different trims all over the world. So I commend Priscilla for this, for her getting this money in and adding it to that. And I think it will one day be good, well, money well spent. And we will have to do a due diligence. But we haven't even started. The Lord Mayor sent me many emails today saying we're going to have consultation, we're going to have this, we're going to have that later in the year. We won't get Frome Road done at this rate in the life of this council. So things are progressing so slowly that I don't think we need to spend 50 grand this year. I think we commit to it, to spend, to do due diligence, but by the time we get the infrastructure in, the slowness of this council, we will have to spend another $50,000 doing another due diligence. Melbourne doesn't work, hasn't worked. London doesn't work particularly well either. By the pictures I sent you with all the bikes lined up, there was never any bike off the rack. And they're cities with great tourist numbers. We don't have many tourists. Now, anybody that wants to ride their bike in the city, my husband, my kids do, Megan does, you buy a bike. They're not that expensive. The only people that would use the hire a bike scheme is the tourists. And we're really not yet a throbbing hub of desperate tourists. And if they do come there, some of them don't want to ride bikes. Having bike stations outside train stations, as was said, we don't have any train stations. We don't have a lot of things in the city. We've got one. And I'm sure they don't want to jump off to drive to where they're going. They can catch the bus and so forth. The system we've got now is perfectly good for what it's working well. It can last a few more years till we start interfering with it. So what I'm saying is let's shift this. Let's endorse it, agree to do it, as we did when we voted for the amendment last time to the major motion. But let's put all our efforts in towards the rollout of safe, elegant, Danish, young girl designed, already done for us. We don't have to get anybody from Melbourne to tell us what to do. We've got them all there. But clearly that's not going to happen. So I just think we're doing this too early. The experts clearly said you must wait till you've got this safe infrastructure. And I totally disagree with him. He said that there is an argument to say that you can put your free bike scheme up there and that will push the infrastructure. That's like, here, you go over the wall and we'll decide to shoot somewhere else out of the trenches. You cannot put people in free bikes and set them out into our dangerous road system. We've got to make it safe first and then we'll do this. But that's a long way down the road. As I said, by the time this council gets off it and decides to redesign the one we've done, we will have to do another due diligence because it'll be so out of date. So I think hold your fire and force the Lord Mayor to agree to positioning his council towards a sensible rollout of something that's already been designed over and over and over and over again in European cities and stop it being such a talk fest.
Councillor Clarahan.
I understand Councillor Moran's concerns and she seems to feel that she's got the solution. I went to Princeton, Washington DC, Austin, New York, and every single place I went to, I checked out the share bike schemes. And they vary in technology, but one of the significant things we found was that the bike share program needs to be more than a return to point of where you pick the bike up. That just doesn't work. If you're going, you know, from home or from work to somewhere to have dinner and a few bevvies, the last thing you want to do is hop on a bike and ride back and deliver that bike. I mean, there are lots of reasons why people don't want to return the bike to where they picked it up from. And hours of operation, for example, of that business where you pick the bike up, I think is a great restriction on the share scheme. My concern is around Adelaide as a smart city, as well as the carbon neutral agenda. I mean, you know, every scheme I saw was different. And I know in Princeton, for example, they had huge boxes on the back of the bike that contained the technology for registering who the rider was, etc. And I just thought, surely we would be looking at the smart technology, and if it doesn't exist, I mean, ideally you'd want, if you're going to have your bikes with some sort of technology associated with them, you'd want wayfinding, you'd want tracking and security, and you'd also want PayWave, if nothing else, you know? And so I'm thinking, you can't just click your fingers and come up with a scheme like that. You've got to get to work on it. And I think, and that's why I would say there's a lot of things we need to resolve, but I think we need to get started on it, because it will take a long time to come up with a good scheme that includes our smart city component to it. So I'd say let's get moving on it now. And you know, there will be a time when we need all the balls in the air. We can't just wait to finish one thing before we get started on another.
Thank you. Now, Councillor Cavill, you put your hand, but you have to. You'll get a chance to sum up. So, Councillor Vishaw.
Thank you. I think it sounds like the whole council spends their holidays photographing cycling schemes. I agree with Councillor Carahan. Yeah, myself included. I do agree that the A to B scheme is an outcome that is desired, and those of us that were here when we did the Valley City Cycling Conference, the Global Cycling Conference, there were a lot of lessons learned. So this sort of whole thing has been a long time coming and has had a lot of thought behind it. Could administration please advise me what the timelines are for the design and approval of the actual infrastructure? And so that my thinking being that once we've sort of got a design approval and actually totally understand what the infrastructure looks like, then the feasibility would be based on that.
Yeah, I was through the chair, just to clarify, you're talking in terms of that $11 million.
Yeah.
But yeah, so the intent is that over October, November, we'll be doing some engagement with key stakeholders. As part of that, we'll identify a series of bikeway typologies and do some cross-section designs that will be costed, so we can get a good understanding about the cost to implement the full chrome bikeway. We still need to determine an east-west route. So the intent is that in November we'll go up with the options, or the preferred option for the east-west, as well as some bikeway typologies and concepts for the Frome Street South bikeway.
Right. Any more speakers? I think that's it. Councillor Cobell, sum up.
Yeah, look, we've got the $11 million set aside, and from the council decision in July, from the 12 was to set aside $1 million for the allocation up to for a city bike share scheme. And, you know, it's been accused that we should be, was suggested that we should be careful and this is far too soon, but on the contrary, I think that it's the right time. We're midterm on council, we've got this money set aside, let's do our due diligence, let's undertake this work concurrently together while we're doing our planning for the use of the other portion of the budget, the $11 million, the infrastructure, the enhancements to our cycling networks, and then when we have the report and all of the information we need, we can make the decision about when we're actually going to implement the right share bike scheme for this city.
Members, I'll put that. All those in favour? All those against? That's carried, but division is called. All those in favour, please stand.
Councillor Vishaw, the Chair, the Lord Mayor, Councillor Hender, Councillor Slimer, Councillor Abbeyard, Councillor Clarahan.
Thank you, members. I now go to item number 8, Councillor Vishaw. Sorry.
Sorry.
Thank you,
Chair. I did actually want to draw members' attention to the advice from APLA. There was quite a long discussion at APLA about the meaning of temporary, and there was a very strong feeling by all members that a three-year period was not temporary, and especially if we do a review, you know, at the end of that 3 years, which means then there's another period of time before it gets changed. So APLA very much supported a one-year extension with a view that the review was being done and also that they have some time to come up with a solution, come up with an alternative.
Hey, Councillor Bashaw, are you moving?
Oh, no. No, I'm not.
Oh, you pulled it out. Well, you're not moving.
Well, I wanted to speak to it first.
Can we move an amendment motion?
So, who is moving something?
I will move an amendment to the motion. So, you might want to do that first.
Yeah.
The motion.
No, not an amendment, an alternative motion. Yeah, I know what she means.
Thank you.
Up to 2 years.
So, from 1 year to two. Well, I'll stick with what was discussed at APLA. It's up to 1 year.
So, as what's written on page.
Page 15.
Yeah, just can you just read out exactly what you want to? But as per the as
so
per one, you got one.
Approve the retention for one year. Temporary retention for 1 year.
For 1 year of two shipping containers. Each 2.4 meters by 12 meters.
That's right. Okay. Yes, that's fine. And then the location and design solution.
You'll have to change 1.2 as well.
Yeah, that was not approved.
Do I remove that?
That it was, I think it's up there actually. Yeah, I'd like to remove that, thank you. Not that one. The approval of the painting and the mural.
Oh, hang on, we'll get to that one. What about 1.2? You've got to deal with that. First.
Location and design solution focus on
review this. Of the process for both containers in 1 year's time, is that what you're saying?
Within the year.
Within 1 year. Alright, okay.
And 1.1 is that the second container be painted externally to match the existing one.
Because so that's isn't that 0.2 about the mural?
It's in 1.1 actually, because it was talking about use of timber dressing artwork and plant.
Okay, so come back to that because so are you not approving the painting of a mural? Is that what you're saying?
That's correct. That
so you're taking out number two?
Yep.
All right, and therefore what 1.2 then changes to location design for both containers focus on the use of timber dressing to remove artwork? Is that what you're saying?
Yes, it's actually because there's one container there and there's another container coming in. So the two containers aren't there, there's only one.
Yeah,
so this is saying so. The second one can come in, and the second one is to be painted externally to match the existing one.
Location
that is what
design.
I'm asking for.
Okay, well, let's just do a new 1.1 then. The second container is to be painted the same as the...
Externally to match the existing one.
Be painted externally. To match the existing container.
Yeah.
All right. We've got we in the right space.
And then 1.1 goes out.
I'll hit a second.
Yep.
I'll have
it. Okay. And a seconder? Lord Mayor. Okay, now you can talk to it. Councillor Bashaw?
Sorry, Chair.
Now you can talk to it.
Now I can talk to it. I refer to page 15 of the papers, which is the APLA advice. There was a very long discussion at APLA about precedence in terms of putting containers into the parklands, and that there certainly wasn't a desire for a second container to come in and then both containers stay there for 3 years while we do a review, at which point that would probably then be extended. This does allow us to do a review. It does allow us this to come back in should they need extended time to find a solution. It's also, there was a thought of them being painted the same. So externally, they are quiet in the parklands. And further to that, that the design for the mural to be painted on the northern wall wasn't something that APLA thought was in keeping with the parklands aesthetic. That's it. Lord Mayor?
Thanks, Chair. I totally support the motion as it stands before us. And really, APLA had a very informed debate, as Councillor Vershaw said. Just members, imagine the precedent of every sporting club in the City of Adelaide wanting a container because they're a little bit short on storage room. And this has got nothing to do with the athletics clubs involved. They're great clubs, great clubs. It's all about the precedent. That if we set this precedent of one container, two container, three container, one sporting club, two sporting club, three sporting club, where does it end? And I don't think containers, it does sound like a song, but I don't think containers really are appropriate in our parklands. I think it's something that we should go to great lengths to avoid, not great lengths to encourage. So this 1 year for two containers will provide a stopgap, but it really does put the onus back on the clubs to come back to us with a practical longer term solution. I just don't think that containers are something we can condone in our parklands. The building, as in the brick or the Besser Block building, is not a particularly redeeming building. So keep it green, let it fade into the background in terms of the parklands. There's no need to make a feature of that building because there's nothing to feature. So I think APLA had a very informed position, so I support Councillor Bishop.
Members, do I have any other speakers? Councillor Wilkinson.
Echoing the sentence of Councillor Shaw and the Lord Mayor, you can't make a silk purse out of a sow's ear, so we shouldn't be a silk purse out of a stunt on the parklands. We shouldn't be trying to dress it up with checkers or things to be used as bases to do more containers elsewhere.
Councillor Curran.
Yes, look, having seen the container that was located down on Park Terrace with the new community garden and with a mural painted on it, it actually doesn't look an unattractive building. I think there is, because of the sturdiness of a lot of those containers, there is the possibility that they actually are fit for purpose in terms of providing security for people, for sporting clubs and other activities, community gardening groups, for example. However, I would be very concerned about the presentation, the aesthetic, and so, you know, if we were to allow people to use them, I would be very concerned about the way in which it is presented. And I certainly am not in favour of the proliferation of containers around the parklands that look like containers, but there is the potential there for sort of for them to be adapted and done in an aesthetically pleasing way that perhaps doesn't stand out, but at the same time doesn't look like a container. I'm just wondering, my concern is with the 1 year review, would that have the result of stopping them from actually acquiring a container because of the uncertainty of a year long lease or access only?
Through the chair, from the discussions I've had with the club, no, that doesn't seem to be the case.
Okay, that's good. Happy to go with that. Lovely, thank you. Councillor Bishaw, do you want to sum up? Summed up. Members, I'll put that. All those in favour? Declare that carried. Thank you. Members, I now go to other business. I believe Councillor Moran, you have a motion without notice.
I've got two.
And Councillor Moran, I've got one of them.
Mm-hmm.
And you also alluded that, in fact,
I did, but I meant it to come to council tonight.
So you're going to do it without notice?
Put that as council to committee tonight.
Yes, if you like. So
it's been one of the council meetings next Tuesday, so I'm happy for that, seeing it's going to be in the agenda.
Sorry, I just didn't use it. Are you going to do it without notice tonight?
No, well, I won't, I'll leave it.
I just want to have a question. But you've got one without notice regarding a town hall meeting?
It's on notice, so they'll have it. That the Strategy Planning and Partnership Committee recommends to the council that council convenes and hosts in the town hall a public meeting during the month of September for the purpose of hearing views of ratepayers and other parties not permitted to make their own submissions but relying on the LA City Council submission to represent their views on the state government's local heritage discussion paper. Now that was the motion that I put so to you.
I'll just call for a second.
I'm happy to change it. To change it to be three separate forums. I'm looking at the administrative comment. Three separate forums: south, east, south west, and north Adelaide community centres.
Hang on one second. So convenes and hosts in the town hall still? No, you're taking that bit out.
Taking it into the local communities.
Three separate forums. And then just put in brackets, south, east, south, west, and north of Adelaide.
Now, I would have rather had it in the town hall, I think, because it's a bigger.
So you want three separate forums in the town hall?
No.
So what do you want then?
Still leave the town hall as one of the forums.
There'll be four in total?
What about we just say host public meetings? The necessary public meeting.
Well, yeah, you could just do that.
Yeah. Perhaps I could leave it vague. Perhaps I could say in a.
Why don't you go back to what you had? Sorry to.
Well, I have spoken to today.
Well, let's just go back to what you had.
Okay, look, I'll go back to what I had, and if that is not possible in the time frame that the community centres be considered. Is that okay? So I'll keep to my original motion, but just for the plan.
Convenes and hosts, remove out the town hall. A series of public meetings?
No.
I know.
Just one public meeting. Convenes and hosts in the town hall, a public meeting during the month of September. If this is not possible, convenes them in the various community centres. I've been told that it's very difficult to get to town hall at short notice.
Well, we've still got the church out the back.
And all.
But we can put this in brackets.
And or the Methodist Meeting Hall or the various community centres. Let's go to the Methodist Meeting Hall then.
Okay. Can I go back to your original motion and put convenes and hosts in the town hall or the Methodist Meeting
Hall?
Methodist Meeting Hall or other venues.
Or other venues, yep, yeah, that's good enough. I think.
Happy to second it.
Lord Mayor's town or other community centres. And then delete that if sentence.
Yes. Look, I think this is self-explanatory.
Seconded, Lord Mayor.
We obviously have a huge problem with the state government's local heritage discussion paper that we got to see in time. We must have a leadership role, but we also must consult quickly with our ratepayers. Now, the Lord Mayor's arranging a mayor's forum, so that's bringing together the state, but we mustn't forget that our first and foremost role is to represent our ratepayers of the City of Adelaide and not including North Adelaide. And this will give them a forum. I hope that some way it is able to be in the town hall because it gives it more a matter of authority and people that should come in. So that would be my really preferred one. But other than that, I think it's really self-explanatory. I recommend the motion.
Lord Mayor.
Thanks, Chair. I think this is a very good motion from Councillor Moran. I think it's very complimentary. Because members, of course, City of Adelaide has more than 25% of the state of South Australia's local heritage listed properties. So we are a prime mover when it comes to impact of this whatever plays out subsequent to this discussion paper. So, Chair, Councillor Moran is exactly right. On the 21st of September, we will be holding a forum regarding this matter, regarding this discussion paper. We'll be extending invitations to 68 councils throughout the state of South Australia, recognising that this is a state bill, and we have to bring all of our fellow councils into this debate. Together we will be considerably stronger. That's very important. So we'll have mayors, we'll have elected members, we'll have CEOs, and we'll be extending invitations to our key personnel and staff within those 68 councils who have expertise in this matter also. So I think this is very complimentary. And for us in tandem to be having one or more community meetings with our own constituent base is critically important. So well done, Councillor Moran. I completely support this. I think it's we need to work on various levels at our local government area level and also with our fellow councils throughout the state of South Australia, metropolitan and regional, in order to effect the best outcome. So I support this.
Councillor Wilkinson. I commend Councillor Moran for this motion, Lord Mayor, his support of this. I think it's imperative that people at our constituents actually know about this meeting or meetings. We do ads in the Messenger for Splash and things like that. This is far more important than Splash, so we should be putting this in the paper. You know, we should be advertising it properly. It shouldn't just be put on the council website where no one finds it. So I think it's imperative that it's advertised in the Messenger, the next one that comes out. And I think it's better that it's in the town hall. I'm averse to being one bigger meeting rather than the multiple thing. I think we want to gravitise you. We want it to be seen that there's a lot of people concerned as opposed to fragmenting it into smaller groups where then John Mauer says, oh, it's just a rabble over there and a handful over here, and then no one's really concerned about it. And it's better if we make a bigger deal of it, do something properly advertised in the town hall where you get a substantive group of people together. I don't think it's really necessary to have the geographical sort of divides. The divide and conquer things. I'm getting what we're trying to accomplish here. We're actually trying to bring together and unite, not divide and conquer. So that's my views on it.
Councillor Moran, do you like to sum up?
I sum up.
Members, I'll put that. All those in favour? Declare that carried. Members, I'll now.
I've got another motion.
I've got another one?
Yes. Sorry for not printing it out. I would like to ask that the CEO convene an urgent confidential CEO's workshop to get the elected members' feedback regarding the review that the administration is undertaking now on the standing orders.
Do I have a seconder for that? Councillor Abiyan? Councillor Moran, you've got a second.
Well, I understand that the administration is undertaking a review and rewriting some of the standard orders. I think it's very important that that we as councillors get an input before it's written. It's always a bit awkward when the administration's written things and we have to then undo them or we don't agree with them, and it creates a conflict situation. So I would like, ideally, I would like the CEO to call it, because there are some urgent matters this week. But if not, I understand.
Can we just get some urgency hands?
On Thursday, preferably. It won't take long.
Through the chair, I'm happy to comply with the requirement. And it's just a matter of how we can schedule that best. But it was intended that we would be talking with council members about the standing orders, as there are a range of changes that we're looking at with regard to meeting structure and other things. So. It goes on the radar, so yes, we will schedule it as soon as possible.
Councillor Abiyad, you're the seconder.
I was a moderator at the stage.
Was it Lord Mayor?
My question was just, we do already have we are already getting together on Thursday, aren't we?
So not in a formal
session. So could we just make part of that a workshop at the beginning and then
I'll ask the question.
Yeah, through the chair, the intention this week is just to have a conversation about that and a number of things. But we really would deserve a dedicated session to deal with a raft of changes. So I think it is going to be necessary to have a number of touch points, and one of them needs to be a full workshop, I think. It's a significant issue to deal with. I believe that this Thursday will be a conversation about a range of opportunities within the Standing Waters that we can look at. But it will need to be followed up with a detailed formal workshop and some more information following the conversation.
So do we need an urgent confidential CEO workshop this Thursday, or do we need to have a conversation this Thursday over dinner and then have a workshop?
Let
me just seek the intention of the mover I can actually... Now, mover, can I just ask you, Councillor Moran? I just want to ask you, if you're saying specifically Thursday, you need to put that in the motion. If you're okay for it to come and urgently defined as soon, then it's up to you just to clarify that.
I would rather it just Thursday.
Then you'll have to, then you'll...
This Thursday is possible.
You want to put that in the motion?
Well, can we just have a sort of fresh step? If there's going to be a series of them, of workshops on the standing orders, as suggested, then there are a few that are more urgent than less urgent. So you could give a half an hour confidential workshop and we could go through it one by one, or section by section. It doesn't have to take up the whole thing, but I think there's some issues that we need to talk about sooner rather than later.
Yeah, well then through the mayor up to the chair. I think it is possible then to have an urgent session on Thursday prior to the other session we had planned anyway, so we can do that for a half an hour period and we can really...
Okay, I'll leave that out of the motion in case it becomes impossible.
Okay, that's good. I think that's taken on notice if I read that correctly. Anyone other speakers? Summed up. I'll put that all, who put their hand up?
That's okay, happy to vote on.
I'll put that all those in favour. Declare that carried. Thank you. Can I now ask for item 14, exclusion of the public to consider confidential items? Councillor Corbell, Councillor Flammer, put that all those in favour. Declare that carried. Can I now ask anyone in those? Oh, sorry, that's for 15 and then now for 16 as well. So, Councillor Kershaw, Councillor Corbell, all the members put that, all those in favour, declare that carried. I now ask members of the public not related to leave and staff not related to that, either of those items, to please leave the gallery and I'll get the door closed and the...
put the reopen the to the public. Okay, members, thank you for your attendance. I'll now close that meeting. Thank you.
We could reopen the meeting, and just for the public record, the Infrastructure and Public Space Committee meeting will be public meeting will be streamed live and recorded, published to the internet. Please note that an audio and visual recording is taken of this meeting. This means that your presence at and any or all contributions you make to the meeting may be collected, used, disclosed, or published publicly by the council, including transferring outside Australia. The Infrastructure and Public Space Committee acknowledges that we are meeting on the meeting on the traditional country of the Kaurna people of the Adelaide Plains and pays respect to elders past and present. We recognise and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs and relationship with the land. We acknowledge that they are of continuing importance to the Kaurna people living today. Apologies and leave of absence. Nil. Confirmation of minutes.
Happy to move.
Councillor Martin. It's an apology, thank you. Confirmation of minutes, if I move on. As I've been. Seconded Lord Mayor. All those in favour of minutes? Those opposed? That's carried. Public forum. We have no public forum. Chair's verbal report. No report to make. We have a presentation for item 7, so we'll reserve that. We'll do a call over for the other items. Item 8, Adelaide Town Hall carpet replacement. Item 9, proposed of land acquisition. Item 10, regulated tree removal. Okay, do I have a mover for those items 8, 9 and 10? Lord Mayor, seconded Councillor Abiyad. All those in favour? All those opposed? That's carried. There's also item 11, commence a road process to close and transfer an unnamed public road west of Nelson Place. Do you want to call that one out?
Do you
want
to call it? No.
Okay, I put that. I've got a mover, Lord Mayor, Deputy Lord Mayor to second. All those in favour? All those opposed? Thank you. Sorry, I missed that before. Now we have a presentation.
Excuse me.
Yes, Councillor.
We've had many a presentation, and I don't want to waste staff time. We have many a presentation. I don't know anybody here that's not voting for option one for the extra money. Do we really need a presentation at this latish hour? I'm perfectly happy to include the motion as printed.
Councillor Moran, thank you for that. I understand there's broad support for option one. There were two alternative colour schemes presented, and I think it would be valuable for the committee to see those two alternatives. Both pertain to option one, but if we could see those two, then the members can then make an informed decision.
Sorry, so you're saying we do need it in order to have a look at colour scheme?
Yes.
Short one.
Where's that on the motion, Chair, that we have to pick a colour scheme? Option one. We're picking option one.
Option one, as shown.
Sorry, is there? I don't understand.
There's option one is the configuration of room, but there's a pale blue colour scheme, and then there's a terracotta colour scheme. So it's just not changed for members to see.
In that motion, where does it say we have to pick a colour?
Well, the report hasn't actually provided the opportunity to choose, but both options have been prepared, and I think.
Let's have a look.
Members to see,
good to have a look.
Given that work has been done, so we can see those two options, please.
I'm happy to move it.
Here we go.
I'll do that.
Okay, the other one?
So that's the terracotta colour scheme.
Can you put them side by side
so that we can see that we've got blue? Oh my goodness.
Can I just?
There you go.
Can you have it a boy or a girl?
I like
Chair, can I suggest that the expert speaks to the rationale behind the pros and cons of these colours, and then we can move on with the matter?
Yes. If we could just keep the further to Councillor Moran's comments, just keep the thing brief and really just to the difference between the two colours. I think your one's agreed on the configuration.
Sorry, still on that. Obviously, the recommendation is for the blue. Okay, so that's what we're going to hear now. So why can't we just say yes, the blue?
Because I'd like to have some input, however briefly.
They're going to only give you input for.
I'd just like to have a discussion.
That's what we're here for, it's a meeting.
Okay, if we could have a brief presentation, please.
Thank you, Chair. I should just explain, we did produce two different schemes, two different colour schemes. Basically, we recommended the blue in the end because of a certain concern about the lighting in the room. We were a little concerned because of the nature of the new lighting. It is somewhat limited what we can actually achieve in there. We are a little concerned that the red scheme might be a bit dark given the current lighting levels in the space. We were also looking at trying to make the room feel a little bit more feminine, so that's the reason why we the nattier blue sort of Wedgwood blue colour was selected also, because historically there was a reference to that colour being used in the space. It's the only reference we have of colour being used in that space, but I mean obviously the red scheme is another option.
How true is the red in that project?
It's fairly accurate, yes. Yeah.
And what about the blue? How true to colour is that?
Again, it's very cold. It's quite accurate.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Very cold colour and very bluey blue.
Can we get rid of it?
Well, let's
have
a vote on red or blue.
So we've heard the rationale, so perhaps if you just have that.
Why don't we have a green option as well?
You're asking me to choose.
Thank you very much for that presentation. Questions from the Councillor Clarahan first.
At the Art Gallery of South Australia, they do use burgundy on some of the walls and they look absolutely stunning. However, I am aware that there is actually a skylight in that room, which obviously has a huge impact on what the room looks like, as opposed to this room, which has no skylight.
Yes, that is correct. In fact, the red colour in there is the same colour that's used in the art gallery. But that is my only concern, is that the lighting levels in those areas are quite different. There's quite a lot of light in the art gallery, whereas I'm just a bit concerned, given the fact that we're only dealing with occasional spotlights on the walls. As long as everybody understands the implication, I suppose that's the only thing that I would be a little concerned of.
Could I ask you, is that a cool blue or a warm blue that you're advocating for?
Well, I guess our description would be a Wedgwood blue. So I suppose it would be a cool, yes, yeah. So
that's got a bit of warmth to it or not?
A little bit, I'd say it's more on the cool side, I think, realistically. So.
So just to be, so I'm sure it's with this carpet or a version of this carpet?
That's the next item.
No, we're past that item actually. I'm asking about the colour that we've...
We actually have done, this is the carpet, which is the one up this farther end, which is intended for the Queen Adelaide room.
Okay.
This is the carpet intended for the blue scheme.
Yep.
But there is another one for the red scheme.
So we'd have to do another carpet?
It's exactly the same design, but the colouring is different.
Councillors, can you just listen up? Because what the suggestion is, if we're going for a red colour, then we're also going to have a red carpet or a change colour carpet, which means we'll have some of the town hall with blue carpets and some with red carpets.
That's why I said we shouldn't have had the presentation, because we've passed everything else. So clearly blue is what we have to go with.
Okay. One further question. Did I misread it that in fact there was going to be a light patterning on those walls, that it's actually actually it's a...
It is a wallpaper.
It's a wallpaper, yes. So it might just be a harsh, which would...
No, correct. So it's basically a quite a small leaf pattern overlaid. So when you see it in this context, you don't actually pick up that pattern. But if you do zoom in on, if you could zoom in on those, you could actually see
so
that.
So it's not the lattice work. Yeah.
It's not the lattice work.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, sorry. Keep zooming.
Yeah, I can just see it, which sort of softens it, doesn't it? Yeah, and warms it up, I think. So, I mean, I think from my point of view, because we're wanting to make sure that we have a cohesive look and a carpet that brings it all together, I'd be very loath to do any car other than the blue.
Okay, that's what you recommend. Yeah, I'll go with what
they recommend. Lord Mayor. Well, Chair, I must say on behalf of other members, I'm very happy that we are all very supportive of option one. That's an important thing to note, that this really is a magnificent room, and I think it will serve our city well for many decades to come. So I think we all acknowledge it's a very good investment. So thank you, Andrew and team, because that's terrific. It's absolutely great. And also, it's a large room, but it's not a voluminous room. So the lighter colour probably gives it a greater sense of space. Also, the art, which we have terrific art, much in archive, which we can begin to curate more through this room, may reflect better off that wall colour. And Deputy Lord Mayor's just some consistency about tone of our carpet throughout the whole building. So I think my view is we should go with the expert opinion here, but it's I'm just very happy that everyone's supportive of option one. I think this is a wonderful outcome. So.
And it'll be a great story to tell as well.
Councillor
Cobell.
Yes, I did hear that there's greens. If there's possible to see the green option as well.
Where Robert's thinking, we're just commenting that the red skin does better with skin tone.
Everyone will look a bit sick in that room, won't they?
In the blue one.
Okay.
Yeah.
No,
that's my concern.
The blue one.
Members, if I could just briefly speak.
Oh, no, Chair.
Speak briefly.
Speak, Sam.
Thank you. I'm very pleased with how this has progressed. It's a far cry from the fit out of the Siegel Playford Hotel, which is what an earlier proposal originally looked like, and now it's a befitting fit out of this room to the original design. Ironically, we had earlier in the agenda Edmund Wright House, to the original design of Edmund Wright House from the original competition design for the Adelaide Town Hall, which is a terrific thing. As chair of this committee, I did want the members to be able to see the two options. The agenda only showed the blue option, didn't present the blue or the terracotta option, and I wanted the members to have the benefit of seeing that, so we may just be presented one option, but actually being given that opportunity. So I'm open-minded and was really open to the views of the other members, their preference, but I did want members to see the terracotta option as well as the blue option. I personally prefer the terracotta option, but I'm happy to go with the majority view and acknowledge the desire to have a femininity of what is the Queen Adelaide room. And fundamentally, the architecture is correct. And thanks to the great work of Andrew Clinkey, who's been very diligent and thorough, and it's he that actually discovered the original drawings of Edmund Wright, and which brought us to this point. So thank you for your great work on this. I now ask for a mover.
Yep.
Councillor Clarahan, Lord Mayor, second.
I've moved it four times.
Sorry, Councillor Clarahan.
It's all right. Look, I know this is going to cost us more, but I think the outcome will be a very elegant one and hopefully quite breathtaking in comparison to what we've got now. So again, I'd like to thank all those involved, both administration and crew too. There's been a lot of hard yakka put into this to get it this far.
Thank you.
So, and including yourself, Councillor Wilkinson, thank you for your contribution.
Lord Mayor, Secretary.
So I'd just like to acknowledge Councillor Wilkinson. I reserve my right to speak, but I'd like to acknowledge Councillor Wilkinson.
Councillor Moran? Okay, any other discussion? Back to the mover, to someone?
Thumbed up.
I put that, all those in favour? That's carried, thank you all.
Let there be blue.
Other business? Item 14?
Well, why do you vote for it?
Thank you, Helen, thank you, Andrew, very much. Councillor Antic, motion on notice, open space between Mill Street, Wright Street and King William Street.
Where is that?
Councillor Antic.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Although it was really printed, then I'll speak to it.
Seconded, Councillor Moran.
Thank you, Chair. Look, the motion calls for council to, or recommend to the community, to recommend council that the Lord Mayor and the CEO write to the state government to request enter of use for the open space between Mill Street, White Street and King William Street. Now, I'm not sure if council committee is familiar with that space, but it's the space which is visible from King William Street, an L shape of land, which was in 2012 and before earmarked for the courts precinct. It was for those who work around the area, it's a long derelict site, I suppose, which has been sitting there for decades, really. And the legal profession has been calling on that site to be developed for a very long period of time. And it's unfortunately, right at this very moment, it's still lying fallow, so to speak. The intent of this came from a comment made to me by a local business who operate there and who have the now fairly onerous duty of looking out onto an empty block with two portaloos and a surrounded cyclone wire fence. And from what we've seen, the state government seem to have little intent on prioritising that project. In fact, you know, it seems to me that the state government are intent on talking the talk with law and order, but can't seem to walk the walk on prioritising what the Attorney General described as this absolutely essential infrastructure in the area. So to me, it seems that when we've seen during the week a story about the state of the crumbling courts building. It's a courts building which was actually not accessible by the former Chief Justice when he was injured. It was reported at the time he couldn't get into the building without using his wheelchair. So he was injured temporarily. So look, this space has been a long standing problem for the area, and I'd like to see something happen there. I mean, what we've got at the moment, really, as I said, is an open space which is just begging to be used. It's as I said, it's essentially surrounded by cyclone wire, and it's got, you know, sort of other bits and pieces plonked in there. So it's pretty self-explanatory. I guess what it's turned into, though, for my mind, is effectively the legal profession's LaCornu site. There's just nothing happening there. It's almost Groundhog Day. We keep getting promised the building will be built there. So let's see it used. I'm asking that we write to the state government and say, well, look, if you're not going to prioritise this development, then use it for something else. Let people go there and have a sandwich, and I'm asking that they foot the bill as well, because it's not our land, we don't own it, but our ratepayers are blighted with the scenery. So it's as simple as that, and I ask for your support.
Secretary?
Yes, look, it is self-explanatory. The council over the years has approached the government to use it for community gardens. I think we started doing that, but we've sort of chased off. It is certainly like the Cornu site. I think on the bigger picture, the council should really speak to state government about these unused sites in the city of Adelaide. I think, Priscilla, you were telling me in China or Japan that it's automatic. But any empty site, they don't put fences around, the developer or the owner of the site is compelled to put some community use for it and make it attractive. It doesn't make any sense if the answer is no. It often is no, but I agree it's an unsightly, desolate looking little bit of non-gardened area. And I think that the state government should be pleased that the council wants to utilise it. And so I'm expecting a yes, but don't be surprised if it's a no. It's right in the city, and it could be a lovely place for people to sit and have their lunch and grow some vegetables or whatever. I'm not an expert on that, but it could be, it's pretty much used for anything else. But I mean, it is so unutilised, it's ridiculous. So I commend this motion to you.
Councillor Clarity.
Oh, look, my comment was be careful what you wish for, because that's exactly what could happen. It could end up as a food truck location.
I don't really have a problem if it did become a food truck location, actually. Well, if you turn it into a community space, it gets activated, people go there, then you can turn it into a space which has got some nice food nearby, as long as it happens occasionally, not all the time. This is actually of particular interest to me because my balcony overlooks that space. And at the moment, what I've been looking down upon is Portiloos and, you know, like a site office, which were put there probably a few weeks ago. I can't ascertain exactly when and for what reason, I don't know. The block is there's two blocks actually, and one of them is fenced and the other one is open, neither are used. The one which is on the corner with King William Street is just used as a thoroughfare, and there's like a little dirt track which cuts off the corner. And I can't quite work out why one is fenced and one isn't. And I do think that even if the fence was just taken down and the community could come in and encouraged to come in, they could turn that space into some gardens, like community gardens, especially with some simple pallets and things, put in raised garden beds, that sort of thing. So it doesn't have to be a costly project. The fence just needs to be removed, and it's on the basis that it's temporary activation, because we don't know when this courts building is going to actually get done, if it's actually going to get done.
Deputy Lord Mayor.
Can I just suggest an amendment, paragraph 2, and I'm just going to fly it and see whether people are interested. It would be paragraph 2, investigate what mechanisms are available to council to ensure that sites left empty for a period of over 6 months remain unfenced and are activated for community use. So we look at the bigger picture as well, because if there are other cities using these mechanisms, let's use them.
We have to say that.
Beauty.
We have a seconder for that amendment.
I actually need to interject, because I have been advised that there's, you know, potentially, because my balcony does overlook this site, that maybe I have a conflict of interest or some interest to remove myself.
It's up to you.
Okay, I won't vote. I'll become an observer.
If you vote for it, it's okay.
No, then I'll stand up from my chair, so that I'm not in my chair and I don't vote.
It's a decision of the individual member to determine their own conflict, however well or founded that is. Do we have a seconder, an alternate seconder for this amendment?
That's been adopted by the mover and the seconder.
Oh, okay.
So we need to see whether everyone else is happy with the variation.
Okay, so I put that variation. Those in favour? Those opposed? That variation carried.
So that should be, sorry, that now becomes site, that all, not just the site, that site. That left empty for a period.
Thank you. Do we have any further discussion? Could I quickly seek leave to speak? If I may, this site, like the Laconia site, I've got a photograph on my phone, was lined with historic two-storey buildings. And this is what happens when premature demolition is permitted. If they hadn't gone in there and prematurely demolished The buildings are like the Crown and Scepter opposite, all the way down there, it would be a beautiful section of streetscape. And because of premature demolition, and we get applications for stage one development application, which is demolition, and we give consent to stage one demolition, then you get a cleared site, then you get the blighted site. So it's a problem when we give consent to demolition prior to approval for the entire development. It's a real problem. This is had the same thing happen in Hutt Street, where our building is now an open lock car park. So
Wright Street.
And the Cornu would never have been the problem. Wright Street as well had premature demolition not been permitted. So anyway, with that, I put it to the vote. Those in favour? Those opposed? Carried. Thank you. That brings us to other business. The Lord Mayor, motion on notice, public toilets. Lord Mayor.
Thank you, Chair. Before I look for a seconder, Chair, I'm just going to make some changes which might result in a slightly new motion, and then we'll look for a seconder if we can. If ComSec can please, the Infrastructure and Public Space Committee, colon, thank you, because I'm just looking for a report. This won't go to Council until that report comes back. If we could add one sentence on the end, please. No, we can't.
Well, you can tell us and we can amend.
All right, well, I can talk to it. I can plant seeds, can't I?
Yep.
Councillor Perrin?
I think we need a seconder.
Could I have a seconder for what we have before us? Thank you. Members, I won't take up too much of your valuable time,
members,
but of course.
Councillor Maloney?
Chair, our city is growing. And the number of people working, visiting our city and living in our city is indeed growing. So I think it's timely that we check in and just do a audit of our public toilet facilities throughout the City of Adelaide. And in particular, of course, I'm looking for quantity, condition, usage, and insight into supply and demand right across the entire City of Adelaide, whether that's through our CBD area, whether it's through North Adelaide, or whether it's through our parklands. I think this is an important infrastructure issue, members, is that, as you know, that when you travel to any city, public conveniences are something which you always look for. So I would like to be assured, as an elected member of the Adelaide City Council, that we have sufficient supply and sufficient quality. But furthermore, I'd like to know when we talk to the condition of our public facilities, also their accessibility, in terms of where do our public toilet facilities rate in terms of disabled access? I think it's very important. I believe that should be a key part of the report. Taking that a step further is to, I understand that the City of Adelaide only has one, what could be considered a changing place facility for the disabled, and that is currently, of course, at our aquatic centre in North Adelaide. And I'd like this report to also identify opportunities for additional changing places throughout the City of Adelaide. I'd like that to be a key part of this report, Chair. And Councillor Clare, hand further to your comment that possibly in doing that, this report could also look at opportunities for council to provide incentives to private building owners for the installation of changing places in future years. So when we look at public facilities, public toilets throughout the City of Adelaide, that's an important piece. But when we look at changing places most particularly, whether they are located in the public realm, as in on council land, or whether they could be located in private property, as in shopping centres and the like, is there an opportunity there for council to provide some form of incentive to enable that to happen? Because what I understand is the City of Hobart has something towards 10 changing places throughout the city. City of Adelaide has one. And we know that the Central Market is examining this as an opportunity, but surely we can do better. So whether we can do it through our own public realm or whether we can do it in conjunction with private landowners, I hope that report speaks to this too. So members, just consider public facilities as an essential part of good infrastructure throughout the city. And I know that we're a very infrastructure focused council. This is an important part of it. So I commend this motion to you for this report, which will come back from our administration in December this year. Thank you.
Was there something that you want the other members to add on?
Yes, I did. I seeded that with Councillor Clearhead.
Right, okay.
Did you say hang on?
Okay, I'm not going to before you stop talking. So Deputy Lord Mayor, seconder, Councillor Clarahan.
Could I provide a offer an amendment, and I'm happy to receive feedback, that number one requests that administration, number two, this report also looks at opportunities for incentives to private building owners to provide, in commas, change in places facilities. Now, is that covering it appropriately?
Yes, it does cover.
Yeah. And I'll need a seconder for that amendment.
Can't the Lord Mayor, just a point of order, can't the Lord Mayor take that on board? Because it's similar to what Councillor Antic did prior to with just asking, part of the process.
I'll put that to the vote if you'd like to take that.
Because then you can sum up.
No, you need to ask the administration about that.
Just a point of order.
If the Lord Mayor wishes to accept the change as a variation, he may.
Yep, okay.
Sure. There we go. Yeah, I'm happy for Councillor Cohan to pursue this as a amendment to my motion.
And Councillor Corbell is the seconder. Okay. Councillor Corbell, you seconded it, didn't you?
Yes.
Yes, I did.
Right. Can I speak to my amendment, please?
Pretty obvious.
You have the floor.
Oh, I have the floor. So while I have the floor.
But it's not an amendment, it's just now.
No, it is an amendment.
Pass it, right.
Just very quickly, do I need to add something? This is a question to administration. I'll just wait for the chair. So.
This is an amendment.
It is an amendment, yeah. Just a question of administration. Women who use our North Adelaide golf course, for example, have been requesting a toilet on the golf course for I don't know how many years.
Decades.
And our administration, and I'm sorry to say many of them are males that have not had children, keep saying that they can run along to another toilet. And on the other hand, who was saying that, you, Anne? On the other hand, on the other hand, we complain about the dropping numbers of people using our golf courses, and yet we're not prepared to provide basic toilet facilities for those people who do use our facilities. So, you know, you can't have it both ways. So I think in this instance, it would be great if that could be included in the report. And I don't know whether we need to actually specify our own facilities, Lord Mayor or CEO. Oh, who's responding? Administration, I think.
CEO to respond to that question. Councillor Clarahan.
Would we be auditing our own facilities? Is the question.
Yeah, through Chair, yes, we would include our
own facilities. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Corbell, I'm seconding that amendment.
Yes, I
do. Do you finish, Councillor Clarahan?
We're losing people rapidly.
We've still got a
call. Okay, so I put the amendment. Those in favour of the amendment? Oh, that asked you to sum up?
Summed up.
Those in favour of the amendment? Those opposed? That's carried. That brings it back to the substantive. Back to the Lord Mayor.
Summed up, Chair.
Yay.
Those in favour? Those opposed? That's carried. And now go to other business. Do we have any other business? No. Item 17. No items excluding members of the public. I now close the meeting at 11:08.
Well done.
Thank you, members.
I'm sorry.